Hey brother, how you doing?
Doing fine, are you?
Good, good, good. Hey y'all, come on in. How you doing? Sunday night at the revival when she was in an accident, a bad accident,
and she was life-flighted, so we need to lift her up in prayer. Nikki Slaughter was the first one there on the scene, and just give this message to lift her up in prayer. She needs some prayer. I believe we all have special prayers we need to pray about. God knows all about them, though. He's the one who can answer those prayers. The praise team's going to come, we're going to sing a couple of praise and worship songs. Open up the word of prayer. There's some cards in front of you and a few in front of you, decision cards. If you salvation or rededicate your life to the Lord, they'd like to know about it. Real Word Outdoors, David Payton, his team would like to know about it. And keep in touch with you and keep following up with you. And on the back is a blank page and you can write prayer requests. And they pray about it. They go in the woods and they spend their time with God in the woods and they pray about the prayers of the church and that they're at. And go ahead and put your prayer on there. Prayers will be answered. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you. We thank you for your love and your mercy, dear God. We thank you for the opportunity to come into your presence this morning, this evening, dear God. We come expecting a mighty move of God, dear God. We open up our hearts to you. We open up your sanctuary to you, Lord. We pray your Holy Spirit will be turned loose this evening, dear God. Anoint Pastor David, dear God, with your word, that he might speak your word with boldness, that your word would touch and convict the hearts of your people that you've assembled here tonight, dear God. Lord, we put it into your hands, and we ask all this in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you. Let's all stand. We're going to sing a couple of praise songs, and then David and his team are going to pray. Thank you.
Thank you. supposed to stay standing.
Father shows, and the joy.
17. For Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but to us which are saved it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise. I will bring to nothing understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For after that in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. For the Jews require a sign, and Greeks seek after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, unto the Jews a stumbling block, and unto Greeks foolishness. But unto them which are called both Jew and Greek, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. Father, I thank you, Lord, for your precious holy word. Lord, I can't do anything up here by myself. I know I can't. Lord, I've already told you that today, and I know you know my heart. Lord, I've been praying for a real move of God. An awakening is what I'm praying for. But Lord, your people are stiff-necked and hard-hearted. And they have to come to you. I can't do it for them. I've only can deal with you on my own as I did today. And I made a promise to you. I will preach what you tell me to preach. I don't care what anybody says or thinks. I trust you and I'm going to obey you. And Father, I say that not to be boastful. But I say it, if any boasting, to boast in the cross. Because without Jesus Christ, I couldn't even stand here today. And without the cross of Christ, none of us could even be here today. Show us the cross tonight. Let us see with our spiritual eyes the cross tonight. Open our hearts and understanding. Break these walls that is in this place. Tear these strongholds down. Set the captives free. Stir the lazy and apathetic hearts. Let them know that you are in the midst tonight. And Father, whatever happens is good.
We give you all the praise and all the glory. Of course, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Jesus walked the Via Dolorosa with the cross from Pilate's place all the way up to the hill of Golgotha. It's said to be 2,000 feet. He walked. After he was mutilated and beaten, spit on and mocked, a crown of thorns put on his head, and a purple robe, and they whipped his back and they laughed at him and they made fun of him. And he walked that Via Dolorosa because it was a joy for him to get to the cross. He wanted to be on the cross. He wanted to die for you. He wanted you to be forgiven of your sins. In Mark 8, Jesus said before he went to the cross, he called his disciples to himself. He says, "Whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. But whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it. For what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul?" The Lord wants you to take up a cross. He took his up and he walked 2,000 feet for you and died on that cross in your place and mine and rose again the third day. And I think sometimes the church, when we come in like tonight, and I'm going to be real, and it seems like you feel like you were made to come tonight. Some of you, I'm just being honest. What does the cross mean to you? Is it a necklace you wear? Is it a tattoo? What does it really mean? What does it mean to you? Jesus tells us that we are to die to ourselves. That means all my passions for the world, all the materialistic things I want, the stubbornness of how I want my way, and the things that I want it done the way I want it done, it has to go. And I have to surrender to God. And the reason we don't have revival and the reason we don't have an awakening is because you won't surrender. I have to surrender. You have to surrender. If you come here and you're looking for a meeting and you want to hear some singing and you want to hear a message, that's not why I come. I come because I need God to move in my life. I want what I'm seeing happen around the country. I want it. And bless God, if I have to leave Dunn and drive to Texas A&M to get in it, I will do it. I'm sick and tired of it. You see what God is doing, and y'all come in here. Look, I don't even care. You come in here like you just drag it. Why? Wherefore, seeing we are compassed about with so great a cloud of witness, let us lay aside every weight and sin which does easily beset us. Let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. We're dealing with spiritual warfare tonight. That's the bottom line. That's what we're dealing with. I feel it. You feel it. It's here. The cross of Christ broke every bond, every chain, stripped the devil of his power that he had. Do you understand that? Before the cross, Satan ruled. He was in charge. Adam and Eve gave it over to him. But when Jesus said, "It is finished," he meant a lot of things was finished when he said that. Satan's back was broken at the cross. The Bible says, "Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, is a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking who he may devour." He wants to devour you. He wants to tear you down. He wants to make you believe that you can't do anything for God. He wants you to feel that you're incapable of serving God. He wants you to think that worship is about feeling and emotion. And that's what's wrong with some of you tonight. It's not a feeling. It's not emotion. It's simply because He's worthy that you worship Him. He is worthy. So I ask you again, what does the cross mean to you? Have you ever been born again? Because when you're born again, you've got a reason to praise God. You know, the first message we preached here was about the prostitute that came to Jesus' feet. And Jesus told her, and you know, let me just say this. That was on your pastor's heart. When I asked him, I said, before we ever come, I said, what's the scripture that stands out to you? And that's the one you gave me in Luke 7. He said, who is forgiven of much loves much. Who is forgiven of little loves little. How much love have you shown God tonight? Where's it at? What does the cross mean to you? Before I was really born again, the cross was a symbol. It was a symbol of what Jesus done. It was something that symbolizes the Christian faith. But when I got saved on the golf course, January 18, 2003, when I got born again, the cross took on a whole nother meaning. Because I realized that it was my sin that put Him on that cross. My sin put Him on. It wasn't that Pilate made Him go there. It wasn't that He died in the place of just for Barabbas. I was Barabbas. You were Barabbas. We're the murderers. We're the liars. We're the thieves. And He laid His life down freely for us. And Satan cannot stand for God's people to get a revelation of the cross of Christ. Because what the cross really says to you tonight is, I love you. Jesus is saying, I love you. To know the love of God, the height, the depth, the breadth, the length, to understand the love of God, all you have to do is look at the cross. That was God saying to each and every one of us, I love you with everlasting love. And with loving kindness, I'm going to draw you to myself. You can't come to God unless He draws you. I would dare say there are people in here tonight that are lost, but you're on the church road. I would dare say that you said a prayer, the preacher or some preacher slapped you on the back, you got baptized, but you've never been born again. You've never come by the cross. So it really doesn't mean anything. It's just a symbol. It's just a sign. God says, I commended my love toward you that while you were yet a sinner, Christ died for you. This kind of preaching may sound offensive, but the cross is an offense. It's offensive. The cross confronts you and says it's your sin that has to be dealt with tonight. Not your neighbor. Not the person that stole from you. Not the person that gossips about you. Your sin. It's a confrontation between hell and heaven. And God hung on the cross between both and says, I'll make a way. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me is what Jesus said. There's power in the cross. But if you're lost tonight, it's foolish. It's foolish. This kind of preaching sounds foolish to the world. But let me tell you something. When you get a hold of the real thing, it's power. It's power. There ain't a devil in hell that can touch a hair on your head. Amen. When you abide in the love of Christ. Amen. You need to understand that Satan has no authority in here tonight. Satan, you have no authority in here tonight in Jesus' name. None! Some people may have brought in with it. They may have brought something in with them. You have no authority. Whatever's in this house is not of God. It has no authority in here. The power of the blood of Christ that was spilled at the cross, nothing can cover that. Nothing can come against that. Nothing can cross the bloodline. That blood is holy and pure. And when Christ's blood was splattered all over the ground, he was not only paying for our sins, but he was making a way that you could be set free. That you don't have to walk in bondage to an evil spirit. You don't have to walk in bondage to addiction. You don't have to walk in bondage to your habits and the things in your life that you are doing. God sees everything in your life. He wants you to be set free from it. He doesn't want you to be hung in that, trapped in that. That oppressiveness that comes, that depression and anxiety and stress and guilt. God doesn't want a guilty Christian walking the earth. He wants us walking victorious. And the only way you can have that victory is by the cross. You say, well, I've been saved. I know I'm saved. I know I was born again. You still need to come to the cross. Because you get baggage. You get the world on you. You have a bad day at work, or your wife says something bad to you. You say something bad to her. There's always something going on in people's lives. But you know why you need to come to the cross if you're a Christian too? Because when you come to the cross, it's a humbling place. When you say a perfect God who had no sin hung on the cross for a wretch like me, as evil and wicked as I am and can be, God loves me and died for me on the cross. Who am I to not forgive somebody that's wronged me as much as he's forgiven me? When you come to the cross, it takes your pride and just wrings it up and tears it out by the root and throws it. You can't come to the cross with pride. The cross is a pride destroyer. Pride cometh before destruction, and a Holy Spirit before a great fall. God's been dealing with me. He's been dealing with me about this revival. He's been dealing with me about you, about me. And I made him a promise, and I'm going to stick to it. We are in the last days. And I hear amen, and I thank you for the amens, and I believe some of you really mean it. But if you really believed you were in the last days, wouldn't you try to reach a lost soul? How many of you tried to reach today? How many here invited a lost person here? How many even loaded one up in the car and said, you're coming with me? If you don't like this kind of preaching, don't come back. I'm not stopping. I'm not stopping. You got too many people tickling ears and telling you what you want to hear. God wants you to get right. He wants his people to receive what he wants to pour out. It's not going to happen with feel-good sermons and with people telling you how great you are. It's only going to be by the cross. The cross. That cross is a place of restitution. It's a place of reconciliation. People get born again, their marriages get worked out. People get born again, sometimes God heals their body. But even if he doesn't heal their body, their spirit's completely healed. The Bible said, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world. Against spiritual wickedness in high places. The reason I feel passionate and the reason I feel pushed is I know that God has sent me here. And I know the enemy's trying to stop what we're doing. And no matter how hard I preach, if you don't come to the cross, nothing will happen. Nothing will happen. The Bible says that Jesus was blotting out the handwriting, the ordinance that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to the cross. And having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly triumphing over them. The enemy bluffs. He roars. He screams. He's got a big mouth. He's loud. But the Lord has a small, still voice. And you can hear a lot of voices. But the one you need to listen for tonight is that small, still voice. Just speaking to you. Now, I know I'm not living great, and I'm just saying false humility. I'm not a good preacher. I know that. I don't think I'm articulate, cultured. I'm wearing a suit, trying to do something different. But I'm going to be honest. The Lord said, if you be honest, I'll use you. And that's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to be honest. That voice of the God, when He speaks to your spirit, changes everything. Whatever your circumstance is, however bad it is, when you know God speaks to you, it changes the dynamic. Everything changes immediately. And that's the same voice that's trying to speak to somebody tonight. To change everything. What you're dealing with, what you're facing, God wants to change it. But you're running. You're running from it. You come here. It's almost like a fix. You come here to get your fix. You come here to, I'm in church. All right, God, I'm showing you some reverence. But you're running from it. You're running right inside the four walls of this building. You're running the wrong way. You run into everything but the cross. And sometimes God lets you run the wrong way just so you'll get to a quiet place where you can hear His voice. And I believe tonight's that night for you. Elijah ran to a place where he was quieted. A great spiritual victory he had. And then all of a sudden, Jezebel threatened him. And he ran. He called fire down from heaven. Killed a bunch of false prophets. And then Jezebel threatened him and he ran. He was listening to that loud voice, that Jezebel spirit. He ran 180 miles the wrong way. And when he finally got to the cave and God fed him all the way, God cooked him, gave him cakes, an angel looked after him. The Lord says He'll give His angels charge over you. God's protecting you. If he didn't, Satan would try to kill you. God protects all of us. He ran 180 miles the wrong way. Why did he run to Mount Horeb, by the way? I know I'm getting off. I'm just going to beg God. Why did he run there? That was the mountain of God. That's where Moses was hid in the cleft of the rock. He wanted to be hid in the cleft of rock. That's what I think. But what Elijah didn't realize, or maybe he did, it was just being stubborn, is no matter where you run, God is there. And even though you think the Mount of God is holy, right where you're sitting is holy. You know why? Because you're the temple of God. What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost? You're sitting on holy ground. I'm standing on holy ground. The Spirit of God is in me. Therefore, that's my holiness. That's my righteousness. And Elijah was listening to all these things, and he heard an earthquake and the wind, and y'all know the rocks broke. You heard all that, but you know what? That small, still voice spoke. And when he spoke, he says, what are you doing here, Elijah? What if God was to ask you tonight, what are you doing here? Put your name in that place. What are you doing here? How would you answer him? How would you answer him? I can answer him for me. I'm trying to be obedient to you, Lord. I'm just trying to be obedient. I need more of you. I'll go to distance. Whatever you want me to do. Elijah went to distance. When he got touched by God, he went 300 miles back in the right direction. The cross brings everything together. The cross was a moment in eternity. Everything changed. Where God Jesus in the flesh was crucified and bears the scars of the cross now, even now in heaven. And when we look at him in heaven and we see them scars and we see the scars in his feet, don't you know that's going to be powerful? When you realize that's what paid for you to be here. It's not your righteousness. Not because you're good enough. It's because he loves you. And you received him. You received him. When we come to revival, I think sometimes we look for flashy preaching. I like to run the aisles sometimes. I like to stand on the front pew and preach sometimes when I get real fired up. But you know what? That's just show. The cross. The cross is about Jesus. Amen. Not about me or you. Amen. It's his glory. And I pray tonight that every single person in here and watching online, you have been by that cross. And you know the power of his cross. That it's not religion. It's not a fairy tale. It's not a belief system. It's a relationship. See, God bridged the gap between us with himself. And when the devil comes in a service like he did tonight and tried to last night, it tells me that we're close to something. We're very close. Could it be that God want to light this church up to start a flame of fire that would burn across town? Could it be that God is wanting us to take the gospel just across the street over there in that neighborhood? Right down the street here at the gas station right down here. Could it be that God wants you to come to the cross tonight, humble yourself, and repent of what the Holy Spirit is showing you tonight that you need to repent of? The cross is level ground. It doesn't matter if you're a congressman or a homeless person. It's level ground. The cross says, Billy Graham, David Pate, Donald Trump, Joe Biden, anybody that wants to come, level ground. Level ground. Whosoever will, let them come. When Jesus hung on that cross, there was a period where the world went dark. When God turned his back on his son because of the sins of humanity were on him. And he made a statement from the cross. He says, my God, why have you forsaken me? In all of eternity, he had never been separated from the Father. And at that moment, that mysterious time, we don't understand it all. We can't really figure the whole thing out. But at that moment, God somehow separated himself from Christ. And the reason he did that was so you would never have to be. So you would never have to go to hell and out of darkness where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth and be alone for all of eternity. So you would never have to bear the sins of your life and the burdens that you have created. So you could just be free. That's why he took it. I don't know if you're bearing a burden tonight. If you're lost, you're bearing a tremendous burden tonight. You're bearing your own sins. You know God's speaking to you. You sense His presence. And you know, He says, if any man will come to me, I will in no wise cast out. He's drawing you. You come tonight to Christ. You come to the cross and receive Jesus tonight as your personal Savior. Doesn't matter if you're on the church roll. That stuff don't matter. The church roll is not what they're going to go by in heaven. It's called the book of life with what they go by in heaven. And if you ain't written in the book of life, it don't matter how many Pentecostal Free Will Baptist churches you're named in, it don't matter. You must be born again. Come to the cross tonight. Don't waste your life. Don't play church and religion. Come to the cross. If you come here tonight and you're not passionate and you're not searching and seeking God's face, ask yourself why. Ask yourself why. If you come out of obligation, ask yourself why. Because there's something about the cross that makes you just want to shout and say, thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Because in heaven, that's what they do. Worthy is the Lamb. Glory to the Lamb seated high and lifted up on the right hand of God. Get off your feet and give Him praise tonight. Worthy is the Lamb. He's worthy tonight. Has He saved your soul? If He has, wave your hand. Thank you, God, for saving my soul. Thank you that I'm not a wretched sinner on my way to hell, but because of the cross, I can give you praise. Don't let sin and things that you fell into keep you from praising tonight. Ask Him to forgive you and keep on praising. The devil wants you to. He doesn't want you to praise God. He doesn't want you to let go. He wants you to think about that pornographic thing you looked at. He wants you to think about that evil thought you had. He wants you to think about that lie you told. He wants you to concentrate on the bad things in your life. But my God says, I've come to give you life and to give you life more abundantly. He says, I'm able to do exceedingly abundantly more than you ask or think, according to the power that's in us. The power of the cross says, whosoever will, let him come. You come tonight. Come to the cross. Go ahead, brother. Come to the cross. Don't wait. You come to Christ tonight. If you don't know Him as your personal Savior, don't leave here the way you come. Church! Drawing you, why would you come? Why will you not come? What is is out the doors that's worth it. What is outside that's worth your soul? Hallelujah.
Thank you. Oh, Let me go one step farther. If you have not made a public confession. Jesus said that if you're ashamed of me before me, I'll be ashamed of you before my Father. You haven't made a public confession. You're saved, but you haven't made a public confession. I invite you to step out. Come tonight. Come tonight. Hallelujah. Let the brethren pray for you tonight and make that public confession of your salvation. Anyone know? Praise God. Praise the name of the Lord. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. In Christ's name. In Christ's name. In Christ's name. Amen. I said amen. I said hallelujah. I said praise his name. Oh, hallelujah. He's the King of kings. He's the Lord of lords. He's the Alpha and the Omega. He's the beginning and the end. He's the Rose of Sharon. He's the Lily of the Valley. He's that bright morning star. He's the bread of life. He's the living water. Well, his name is Jesus. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. Go ahead and praise God. Amen. We're going to take up a love offering for Brother David and Real Word Outdoors. Brother Nathan, I want you to bless him with a good gift tonight. Thank him for coming and sharing the gospel message tonight in word and in song. Thank you for those that were touched tonight. I know we had one young lady saved tonight. I don't know if there were others. Let's give God a praise offering. Invite some folks to come back tomorrow night. Come on, brothers, we're going to take out this offering. Invite some folks to come back with you tomorrow night. Invite some folks tomorrow. I'm praying tonight that God will lay people on your heart tomorrow. Just pray everywhere you go that you'll meet somebody that you can say, just come. Just come. Just come. God already knows what he'll do, but you got to do your part. We got to do our part. Praise God. Brother Andy Beasley, we pray with all. Father, in Christ's name. Lord, we are thankful. Thankful for your presence, God. Lord, we're thankful for your power. God, we are thankful for your peace. Yes, Lord. God, we're thankful for your praise. God, we are thankful, Father. God, for breathing on us, Lord. Now, Lord, I pray, Father, Lord, as each one of these dear ones heads home tonight, God, that you carry them home safely, Lord. Lord, we continue to pray for Miss Horn that was in that accident, God. Lord, we're praying, God, for your mercy, God, for your healing touch for her. Praying for her family. God, we pray for our evangelist tonight, Brother David. God, and we pray, Father, Lord, for the Real Word Outdoors team, Brother Nathan. God, bless them. Keep them. Let them rest well tonight, God. Lord, let us come back to the house of God, hungry and thirsty, ready to meet with you in Christ's name. And everyone said, amen. 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 God bless you.